Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. On January 23, 1950, the Knesset, Israel's parliament, adopted a proclamation declaring Jerusalem the capital of the State of Israel. 45 years later, the United States Congress passed a public law called the Jerusalem Embassy Act, which urged the federal government to recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital and relocate the U.S. Embassy in Israel from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. Nevertheless, it took 22 years for an American president to adopt the law, with President Donald Trump declaring on the 6th of December that it was time to officially recognize Jerusalem as the capital of the Jewish state. To further discuss the declaration and its significance, I'm joined here in the studio by Professor Hillel Frisch, who is a senior researcher at Bessel Center. Welcome.
Hi.
I'd like also to welcome our TV7 analyst, Mr. Amir Oren, and Professor Zev Chanin, an expert on Russian and Middle Eastern studies at Bar-Ilan and Ariel Universities. Welcome.
Shalom. Thank you.
And I'd like also to welcome Dr. Amira Halperin, who is a research fellow at the Hebrew University's Truman Institute. Welcome. Mr. Oren, give us a broader understanding of the current chain of affairs.
There's a lot of confusion regarding the status of Jerusalem. And while obviously President Trump has delved into the nuances and knows the diplomatic history by heart, nevertheless, not everyone is as well informed as Trump probably is. There were three phases in Jerusalem's recent history, which one must be aware of. You mentioned January 1950, when Israel decided to proclaim Jerusalem its capital. This is because in the 1948-49 war, Jerusalem started out as a corpus separatum, a separate body, by UN Resolution 181 from November 1947. And as the war ended in armistice agreements, there was no change in status. So Israel unilaterally decided to move the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem, and did. Now, in 1967, when East Jerusalem was occupied by Israel, Israel again unilaterally decided to annex the old city of Jerusalem and its environs. When President Trump declared, pursuant to the Congress, what you mentioned, the 1995 law, when he declared Jerusalem as the capital of Israel, he meant probably, didn't specify, West Jerusalem. And here we are not even sure what he meant. We're not even sure what the boundaries of Israeli Jerusalem are, according to his view. But if you look at the maps that the State Department and the CIA publish, East Jerusalem is still outside of Israeli sovereignty.
Professor Frisch, how do you perceive this?
The State Department must be very confused, because the last map that was ever drawn under sort of international agreement looked at Jerusalem as one entity. That's what the corpus separandum was all about. So possibly, maybe if he recognized Israel, President Trump, Jerusalem as the Israeli capital, maybe meant it all, because that was the last official reference is to all of Jerusalem.
Professor Khanin?
Opposite to other parties, like Moscow or Prague or Philippines or some other places in the world, which mentioned specifically a part of Jerusalem, which is the western part, probably meaning that part that was proclaimed Israeli capital after the War of Independence, President Trump didn't make any mentioning of the specific boundaries, whether he'd really meant their pre-1967 line, whether they meant the line which was, you know, Jerusalem was proclaimed the unified capital by the Israeli parliament, Knesset, in 1980. If we will come back to the Moscow issue, they were very hurry to explain to everybody that Moscow, actually a Russian Federation, accepted Jerusalem as the part of the Israeli capital, meaning specifically the western part of the city, but not before the two parties, meaning Israel and Palestinian Arabs, will come to the conclusion and will decide between themselves where they will exactly and actually the border between the two states, but not before these two states will be established, meaning before the establishment of Palestinian states. What does it mean if transform or translate the diplomatic language to our common language? Never. Not in this generation. From this point of view, the any change is actually came from Washington. The question is whether from the Washington also came Yeshua, that means Mashiach.
Dr. Halperin.
This satisfaction of the Palestinians must be looked and observed in a way that we have to understand that the Palestinians themselves didn't decide where and when is the capital of Palestine will be established. If you read what the Palestinians say, the Hamas and Fatah, they say that the capital of Palestine is Jerusalem. They do not divide between East Jerusalem and West Jerusalem. And another thing, what they really say is that what would be important for them are the agreements that are going to be achieved on the ground and not whether the refugees will eventually return to a Palestinian state, but rather the agreement. So I don't see in Trump's declaration any conclusion relating to future negotiation process, because I think that we still have to really sort out what Trump meant and what the Palestinians want. And of course, in the bottom line, the negotiation and the decision must be of the two main actors, Israel and Palestine.
Mr. Ogan, when we're looking at this declaration, obviously its significance is only that today Washington is the supreme power of this world and is capable of dictating various decisions based on its own national interests. And on the other hand, to what end do the Palestinians actually perceive this declaration as binding, considering the fact that they're actually looking at this whole situation as a point where they pretty much declared Washington as an unhonest broker and not more than that?
There are two alternative interpretations of Trump's declaration. One, that it only stated the obvious, that Jerusalem, meaning the Israeli western side of the city, has been the capital of Israel for many decades now, and there's nothing novel about it. The other interpretation is that it is a breakthrough, because earlier presidents, his predecessors, did not want to go so far. However, in the years after this law was passed and as the presidents were signing the waiver, the six-month waiver because of national interest, it didn't interfere with the Palestinian will to negotiate over Jerusalem. Yasser Arafat and Ehud Barak went to Camp David under Bill Clinton, or at the invitation of Bill Clinton. And they negotiated, they failed, but they negotiated the status of the holy sites. Now, if the Palestinians want to look at it from a positive angle, they can find a lot to celebrate in Trump's declaration. Because what he said was, first of all, any sovereign country can decide what its capital is. Secondly, I am for a two-state solution. If you take these two lines...
So long as both parties are interested in a two-state solution.
But that's the extension of that statement. Because this is the preferred solution, it means that eventually there will be a sovereign Palestinian state, and then it could decide that Jerusalem is its own capital, because this is the same logic. But the Palestinians decided to look at it from a negative point of view.
Professor Frisch.
Well, I think that the Palestinians are too divided to decide anything. I think that Trump's declaration is distancing the situation from a potential division into a Palestinian and Israel.
Let me narrow this a little bit. Obviously, the Palestinians have declared a weekend of rage the past weekend. Nevertheless, we didn't see something extraordinarily significant, and most of even the media as well as the security establishment have declared this as something way below expectations. How do you perceive the Palestinian willingness to actually demonstrate such a significant declaration when we don't see enough people on the street actually saying the statements that the leadership does?
I think American support for Israel in declaring that Jerusalem is Israel's capital contributes to Israeli power Israeli hegemony. And Israeli hegemony stabilizes the situation. This declaration will bring more peace in the future. And I think that the local Palestinians are not mobilizing because both the PA and Hamas governments aren't willing to mobilize with them. In other words, the PA is still working in tandem with Israel over security coordination. It's not ready to send its troops to demonstrate. It's just sending young youth to potentially die. And Hamas, the very same. It's sending youth, unarmed youth, to the fence to risk their lives, but they're not sending over missiles, and they're not trying to come through tunnels, so that the bureaucracies, these two bureaucracies, are playing it safe and risking the Palestinian youth's lives. And this is why Al-Quds newspaper has not, which is the most popular media outlet in the Palestinian, has not supported mobilization against the agreement.
Professor Khanin, obviously the declaration by President Trump has bolstered the Israeli narrative when it comes to Jerusalem and has shifted somewhat the international discourse of the Palestinian aspiration of seeking international legitimacy when it comes to Jerusalem, because obviously the United States is a significant actor with significant way when it comes to the legitimacy of providing a country or an entity with somewhat of a recognition. How do you see this challenge being faced by the Palestinian leadership?
Well, in principle, first of all, it is true. I agree with colleagues when they say, or if they say, that actually Trump declaration was the changing rules of the game and actually brings new, not only political, but also legal reality. Meaning that the major force in the modern world, except Jerusalem without, regardless specific, defining specific boundaries at the capital of the Jewish state, Trump mentioned it several times, actually says, we're living in a situation which is totally different. I don't know whether the immediate allusion to compare the Trump declaration with the famous Balfour Declaration is correct, but I think it's really not far from that. But coming back to your question, Hillel wrote in his one of his recent articles, those who actually, I would say, influence the Arab street is this so-called silent majority, which is not interested to fight for the ambitions of their political leaders. That is why Donald Trump was able to make a new move in concern of the questions which are regarded or defined as the core problems of Israeli-Palestinian possible peace solution, meaning settlements, borders, the problem of refugees or so-called refugees and their second, third, and fourth generation, and of course the question of Jerusalem. These questions, actually issues, were so-called preconditions for the Palestinian side to come back to the negotiating table. Before Israel is agreed in our version of these issues, we will not come back to negotiating with Israel. At the moment, Trump is what he's saying. He's saying, okay, these two parties are unable to agree. And I am doing, as he put it, right thing to do. I am doing what is right thing to do. I accept, we accept on the behalf of the United States that this is the Jewish capital. Take it or leave it. And now let's really talk about negotiations. Now negotiation starts without obstacles.
Dr. Halperin, when we're looking at the meager turnout on the streets by Palestinian protesters, most of the people, as Professor Frisch said, were 14-year-olds, 15-year-olds, 16-year-olds who just had a day off and went out to demonstrate and wanted to show some kind of their fierce opposition to this narrative of Washington. However, does the fact that President Trump already on so many occasions came out and voiced his strong support for Israel, for Prime Minister Netanyahu and his policies with regard to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and Israel at large, actually mitigated to a certain extent the Palestinian surprise or kind of weakened their will to confront somebody who they already perceived as a pro-Israeli American leader?
I believe that political activism has been existed within the Palestinian society from 48, how the Palestinians call it, like the Palestinians call it the Nakba, and especially 67. The young people were always trying to get out and to fight for what they believe is right for them. The only difference now is with the digital media and the, you know, the digital era, so we can they can use the new media much more, and they can do what they did in the past, but in much more extensive way. And we also know that following Trump declaration, everything started, which means that whereas in the past, if Trump had to deliver this speech in the past, this was over once he was, you know, off the stage. But once we have the new media, the whole process of thinking about what he said and trying to analyze what he said just started now, when he finishes, actually, when he finished his argument. So I believe that the Palestinians are trying to find really a reason to try again to fight for what they think is right for them. It doesn't mean that this exact declaration is really the spark that would lead to a third intifada. It doesn't mean that this really upsets them. It doesn't mean that they're not ready to negotiation. It doesn't mean anything, in my opinion. It just means that, again, they want the attention of the global community. They want people to understand that there is a problem from their own perspective, how they perceive this problem. They talk about and repeatedly talk about, and I looked at the media in the media of the Palestinians recently in the last week, and they really talk about Palestine and occupied Palestine, occupied Jerusalem, Palestine's capital is Jerusalem. So they really want the international community to understand the problem. And this was just another opportunity for them to do so.
Mr. Oren, when we're talking about the response of the international community, we, of course, would like to start with the American response, in particular the Democratic Party, which was not as happy about Trump's declaration, saying it was counterproductive to peace efforts, and beyond that as well as the Europeans, who were also very direct and very clear in saying this was not the right time to do something like this, and this should become part of the final status agreements that should be negotiated between the Israelis and Palestinians. Tell us more about that.
Well, perhaps not part of the final status agreement, because it's a long way off, but at least of the Trump peace package. And one wonders if he was going to put it on the table in a month or two, why did he hurry to pluck out one element out of the entire package, Jerusalem, and put it on the table now? And one suspects that there were other domestic political considerations involved for Trump himself, not necessarily for Netanyahu or others in Israel, even though, of course, they also celebrated and wanted to use it to their advantage. Now, for the Palestinians, it was a good thing too, because now they can portray themselves as being at a disadvantage. The world owes them one. Trump owes them one. When he presents his ultimate deal, he knows that he must sweeten their lot. He must give them something in return for their anger and suffering at this particular declaration. One more point. In 1948, Transjordan occupied East Jerusalem. It later annexed the West Bank. Of course, only Great Britain and Pakistan in the entire world recognized this annexation, and then they lost both the West Bank and Jerusalem in 1967. But the Jordanians did not move their capital from Amman to East Jerusalem. King Abdullah was killed at Al-Aqsa Mosque, was assassinated there. But Jerusalem was under occupation even under the Jordanians. And the only capital Israel entered by force, Arab capital, was Beirut in 1982. Now, the EU, the European...
I would just like to correct you. In 1960, Jordan turned Jerusalem into a co-capital of the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan.
I stand corrected, which means that they could have claimed it from Israel later. But apparently this was just a symbol. And as we know, King Hussein later disengaged from the West Bank.
But he hasn't changed the constitution yet.
Okay, no, he won't. He died in 1999.
Still maintaining some kind of link.
Okay.
So, you know, he's very flexible.
Well, that means that in their relationship with the other Arab countries, Saudi Arabia and Morocco, they want to have a first claim on Jerusalem. But the point is that the EU, as part of the quartet, along with the UN and the United States and Russia, is with Russia and with the UN on this issue. And the United States stands isolated.
Professor Frisch.
I just would like to point out that for the first time about Jerusalem, the worst kind of state reactions we got were from Iran and Turkey and not the Arab states. The Arab states responded very tepidly. And it was basically Turkey and Islamic Iran that was really the most forceful. Turkey said that it might...
And
it might,
the Arab League as well.
The Arab League, of course, in Lebanon.
It might sever relations. Yeah. And Iranian outlets in Lebanon wrote death to the Jews. This kind of rhetoric wasn't part of the Arab states or even of the PA. And that's very, very interesting. It shows that Israel finds much more understanding amongst the Sunni states against the former imperialist powers over the Arabs, the Turks and Iranians, who want to be imperialists again.
Professor Khanin, with regard to the Russian response?
Well, in principle, Russia doesn't have any position in concern of this question. They just declared that they were the first, before Americans, to recognize Jerusalem as the future state of Palestinians, but currently the state, capital of the state of Israel, and to finalize this issue when the parties come to a deal, which is pretty questionable, as we know.
Nevertheless, they accused Trump of being counterproductive in stating what he states and urged him not to relocate the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem.
That's for sure. On the other hand, when we will take an American case, in a situation when the moving of the embassy of this or that country to Jerusalem means indirect understanding it as the capital of the state of Israel. At the moment, it's not important. Americans did it officially. It's absolutely not important where the embassy is situated, whether it will be in Tel Aviv, Jerusalem, or Herzliya. As for the Russians' point of view, this is important. And Putin at the moment is saying to his counterparts what they would like to hear. When he's talking to Prime Minister Netanyahu, he says, okay, from our point of view, the West Jerusalem is the capital of the state of Israel, but we will do our best that you will come to an agreement with the Palestinian Arab side. When he's talking to Mr. Erdogan, he is saying that we will never accept this. You know, it's absolute mess. We will bring the whole of the Middle East into another, loop of the conflict and the instability. From the Russian point of view, this is not non-issue.
Dr. Halperin, with regard to the neighboring countries, we see also calls by the foreign minister of Lebanon during the Arab League summit or emergency meeting with regard to Jerusalem, that they're calling for sanctions against the United States by the Arab world and to unite in an effort to confront the Jewish state when it comes to Jerusalem specifically, but also in general the recognition they see as null and void. How does Israel actually deal with those threats, and could they materialize into something more hostile?
It's very difficult to Israel to deal with this. I think that there is also a problem that other countries have to deal with. The problem, for example, we saw yesterday in the U.S. Suicide attack that has finished more successfully in terms of injuries, but the bottom line is that there is a Palestinian gathering in the U.S. now and in Europe, not only here, and the threat is in other countries as well. And all of them are for the Palestinians, and all of them are speaking for the Palestinians' rights and against their occupation, against the deprivation, etc. So Israel, again, as we see always, Israel in the end has to negotiate, but the problem is an international problem that Israel must get a cooperation from other countries as well. And it's going to be very difficult, of course.
I looked at American exports to the Middle East, and I hypothesized that it should have fallen during times of crisis when the United States supported Israel fully. Absolutely no effect on American exports to the Middle East. And I don't think that it'll have any effect on American exports now.
Mr. Oren?
Jerusalem is really a non-issue. It was made an issue in two particular fields. One is within the State Department, where the Consulate General in Jerusalem is directly subordinate to headquarters in Washington. It is not under the American embassy in Tel Aviv. It is actually the embassy to Palestine. And even then, only partly, because Gaza was under the Tel Aviv embassy. So the consulate general in Jerusalem does not want to see an embassy there superseding it. The other and more important field is domestic Israeli politics. Mind you, this law, which now Trump has signed 22 years later, or ratified in a way, was pushed through Congress when Newt Gingrich was leading the Republican majority, when Bill Clinton from the other party was the president. And Newt Gingrich was an ally of the Likud in Israel. The Likud won in 1996. A year later, Netanyahu won over Peres under the slogan, Peres will divide Jerusalem. It is really a domestic Israeli issue, also perhaps with the evangelical base that Trump and some Republican politicians have in the States. But in reality, in day-to-day reality in Israel, everybody knows that Jerusalem is the capital. Nobody ever doubted it. It's an issue.
Well, we're drawing near to the end of the program, so I'd like to give each and every one of you the opportunity for a closing statement. Dr. Halperin, we'll start with you.
The Palestinians now are trying to act towards the Palestinians and Israelis towards the negotiation, reconciliation. And the problem is, of course, that violence must be stopped. Once Hamas will be disarmed, maybe that will pave the way, but it's still very difficult to achieve. And therefore, I believe now that the most important thing is to try to calm the people, to understand that if the people of both nations, the Palestinians and the Israelis, will understand that peace is the better thing for both of us, and not only the governments will operate for this, that would be the best thing.
Professor Khanin?
If the task is to turn over the pyramid, you know, departing from Palestinians first and then maybe agreement with the Arab world to the, you know, to the opposite issue, to decide the problem of Palestinian Arabs within the area agreement, I would say that it's a good step forward.
Professor Fish?
The Trump declaration means stronger Israeli presence in its capital, which translates into more religious freedom than any other political arrangement would ever offer.
Mr. Owen?
The Trump declaration means that there is a better chance now for Palestinians to have East Jerusalem as their capital once they have a state, if they have a state. For Israelis, it was not really a historic occasion. It was just stating the obvious, and life goes on just as it did before the declaration.
This is a yes or no question. Is Trump using this declaration as leverage in the upcoming negotiations between Israel and the Palestinians?
If there are negotiations, yes, he's using it.
Well, this is all the time that we have for today, so I'd like to thank Professor Frisch, Mr. Oren, Professor Khanin, and Dr. Halperin for coming here today. And I'd like to thank our viewers as well, and we will see you next time. TV7 Israel's mission is to give you, our viewers, truthful information, which in effect will give you a chance to really understand what is happening in Israel and its region. If you are blessed by our programs and believe our mission to be important, we urge you to support us and become a voice for Israel. You can support us by going to our website at tv7israelnews.com. This program was made possible through your donations.